about patience in trying times. Amen? Patience in trying times. I've come to realize that a lot of things are going on in the body of Christ. And as we all know, whether we like it or not, we all believe that each one of us, we go through our moment of times where we face challenges, trials, obstacles, temptations, different things come against us to hinder our progress, to hinder the purpose of God in our life. And we know why we are going through these challenges, through this trying time. Majority of the time, a lot of the members of the body of Christ throw away the towel. Some people stop fellowshipping with God. Some people stop coming to church. Some people stop studying their Bible. They lost hope. They are saying, man, I don't know what to do no more. Because of their lack of understanding about the force of patience. Patience that brings perfection to our faith in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So this morning, I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you because the God of all comfort is always comforting us. He's comforting us to enable us to understand that we have hope in Him and we should not be discouraged. In whatsoever you are going through in your life, God, our Father, is the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the end. He created us and He has a purpose for us. Purpose to establish us, to prosper us, and not to do us any harm. But so many times, when we're going through all these trials and challenges, we tend to disbelieve God. And we tend to just throw in the towel, thinking that there's no help nowhere, and we turn into pity party and guilt and feeling of God has forsaken me. When He promised that He will never leave you nor forsake you. So if you will talk with me this morning to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 1. Turn with me this morning to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 1. Let us encourage one another today. Of course, I said last time that we were going to talk about prosperity. It is good to prosper in the things of God because God takes pleasure in our prosperity. It is God's desire for us to prosper in all our ways. But in order to prosper, in so many times, that when there is coming forth challenges or trials to hinder that prosperity, and you throw in the towel, you find that you are not able to fulfill the blessing of God in your life. So that is why I say, today I just need to encourage my people to comfort them with the comfort of God. I just want to let my people know that the force of patience, you know, endurance during trying times. Are you with me? So in the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 1, I want us to start from verse 3. Verse 3 says, blessed be God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of our world, of our comfort. Verse 4 says, who comforteth us, who comfort us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to do what? Comfort them which are in heavy trouble by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. How will you be able to comfort your neighbors who have been looking at you as a Christian? Who has been looking at you that your trust in God, you have been posting in your Lord to your neighbors, to your co-workers, to your friends, that God is able. And then during a time of crisis, and then the neighbor is looking at you throwing down the towel. How will you be able to comfort your neighbors, your loved ones, or your co-workers? In this passage of scriptures, the Bible says, blessed be the God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the Father of mercies. His mercy towards us, the Bible says, is new every morning. His mercy is enduring forever. The Bible says, because of his mercies, he has saved us. He is a merciful God. And he's always looking forward to establish you. He's always looking forward to comfort you. And in this scripture, he said that who comforted us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in heavy trouble. That means when God is comforting us so that we may be strengthened during the time of trials, that we may endure in the time of crisis, so that when we fulfill his purpose of endurance and then he established us, we may be able to go and comfort somebody who is going through things and challenges in their life. So that when your co-workers, so that when your friends, so that when your neighbors going through challenges, going through trials, tribulation, temptations, all the crisis coming against your neighbors, you can be able to say, hey, God is able. He has done it for me, he will do it for you. You will be able to say, hey, my dear, do not fear. Do not worry. Rest your hope in God. Because this God that we saw, he is our present help in time of trouble. This God we saw will comfort you during the time of your situation. Amen? Of your crisis. So it's saying right here, who comfort us in all our tribulation, that we may be able to comfort them which are in any trouble, by the comfort wherewith we ourselves are comforted of God. Amen?
Amen?
Are you with me this morning?
Amen.
Do you believe God is able,
yes,
to establish you?
Yes.
Do you believe God is able,
yes,
to change your situation, to work all things together for your good? During the time of your challenges, during the time of your crisis, during the time of your trials, God is saying, I'm able to comfort you. All I'm asking you is to endure. All I'm asking you is to be patient. I'm asking you that I'm working all things together for your good. Because he is the God Almighty who has started good things in our life. He will complete what he started. Fear not and do not be discouraged. And whether you like it or not, you are going to face challenges or trials. No wonder Jesus Christ is comforting his disciples. We will get it. But I want you to turn with me to the book of Romans chapter 15. The book of Romans, just back your Bible back. Get back to Romans chapter 15. That is before Corinthians, the first Corinthians. And let us look at what the scriptures is teaching us in the book of Romans chapter 15. Because in that book of Romans chapter 15, you will find out what I just mentioned here, that when God is bringing comfort to you, when God is establishing you, he's establishing you for his purpose. So that you can strengthen those who are weak. So that you can be able to be there for those who are down. So that we can be able to encourage one another. The reason why you are gathered here today, that you gather here first of all to worship God, our Lord, the one that who has created us, and to believe that he is able to take care of all the things that we are going through in life, that he is able to establish us and is able to direct our life. We came here first of all to give him glory, to give him honor. We came here to give him adoration. We came in to minister unto him, to do service unto him, so that he can minister unto him and do service unto you. Because when you lift him up on high, he's opening heaven on your behalf. He's taking care of your businesses. He's going forward before you. He's sending angels, dispatching the angels to go and take care of your situation. Because I see my children lifting up their holy hands, giving me glory, giving me honor. You could have been in your bed sleeping, snoring, but you left your bed, you came into his house, and you lift up your holy hands, and you give him holy praise. Yes.
Amen.
Because I went to sleep around 2 o'clock in the morning. Yes. After the blessing of the conference, I will still have to stop by brother place who is doing some things. And then by the time we get home, it's almost 2 o'clock. And then I went to sleep at 2 o'clock, but I still have to wake up. You know, automatically, I just woke up because I don't have no choice. I got to be in the house of God to give him praise. Because my redeemer liveth. Amen? Now look with me to Romans chapter 15. In Romans chapter 15, from verse 1, he said, we then that are strong, how to what? Bear the infirmities, that means the weaknesses of the weak. And not to what? Please ourselves. Don't be pity party. No, it's not about you. Verse 2 says, let every one of us please his neighbor, for it's good to edification, to build your neighborhood, to encourage your neighbor, to comfort your neighbor. How will you be able to edify or comfort or build your neighborhood when you are not even having the opportunity to build up yourself?
Yeah.
So, in verse 3, he said, for even Christ pleased not himself. But it is written, the reproaches of them that reproach thee fell on me. Now look at this verse 4. That's what I'm going to talk about, verse 4 and verse 5. He said, whatsoever things were written aforetime or beforetime were written for our learning, that we through what? Patience. Somebody say
patience.
Somebody say with me again,
patience.
That we through patience and comfort of what? Of the scriptures might have hope. Now, verse 5 says, now the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one towards another according to Christ Jesus. In my Amplifier Bible, it says, whatever was just written in the former days was written for our instruction. Amen? That by our steadfast and patient endurance and the encouragement drawn from the scripture, we might hold fast to and cherish hope. The Bible says, Christ in you, he is the hope of glory. True the scriptures. The Bible says we were comforted. Is that not what the Bible is saying right here in verse 4?
Yeah.
That was things, so other things were written at one time. The word of God that has been written for us, they were written for our instruction. They were written for our learning. To learn about all the Old Testament people who went through challenges. To learn about Old Testament men and women of God who went through trials. We read about Daniel who went through the lion's den, but God brought him out. We read about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego who went through fire, but God brought him out. We read about all the people of God that have gone through crisis, but we have seen the testimonies of all these great men and women of God who brought God brought out. So God is comforting us. He's using these scriptures. He's telling us that through the former written of the scriptures, we are what? Comforted. Are you with me?
Amen.
I say, are you with me this morning? He said that we through patience and comfort of scriptures might have hope.
Amen.
Our hope is in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Our hope is in the living word of God. The Bible says all scriptures is given by the inspiration of God and is for the purpose of correct to instruct that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly equipped for every good works. The word of God is quick and is sharper than any two-edged sword. The word of God is powerful. That same word of God is able to mold and to shape us. That is why we come forth into the house after you have ministered unto God. The man of God is ministering unto you. As I'm sowing the seed into your heart and the seed is falling upon the good ground of your heart, then there are comfort changes. But changes don't come sometimes automatically. There are some times we have breakthrough. There are some times we receive healing. We receive the desire of our heart immediately. But there are some times we have to wait. Waiting time is patient time. It's patient time because you are putting trust in God. You know that there will be one day God is going to make a way.
Amen.
That God will not leave you. That God will not forsake you. That God loves you and he created you in his image and after his likeness. Let me ask you a question. How many of you parents here hate your children? No, that's a bad parent if you hate your children. But the Bible says God is a God of love. That his love towards us is unconditional. And because his love is unconditional, no matter what you are going through in your life, no matter circumstances, no matter the crisis, the Bible says that God demonstrated that love towards you, that when Christ died for us, he was dying for the sake of the world. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Are you with me?
Yes.
The God of all comfort. He came to die, to give us life, to give us life abundantly, and he will fight to make sure that we enjoy that abundant life. If he died to save you, he lives now to keep you. I always use that word, that if he died to save you when we were yet sinners, now that he is living and that he is alive, now that he is the head of the body, the church, he is now alive to keep us.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen?
God is alive to keep you. God is alive to establish you. God is alive to turn your situation around. He is alive to work all things together for your good. All the bad things of your life, you just be patient. You just stay with God. You just stay in his word. You just stay in church. You just stay prayerfully, giving him glory and giving him honor. You will find out they are coming for a day and you will hear through it all. Because it will work all things together for your good. Your situation that you think is bad. You think you are the only one going through something? Oh my God. You think you are the only one going through something? Do you know what the people of God, the men of God, were saying here? If you read that word very good, even in that 2 Corinthians, you will find out all this thing. In the 2 Corinthians chapter 1, when we first read the Bible, 2 Corinthians chapter 1, if you see everything that all these apostles were going through. In verse 9, he said, but we have the sentence of death in ourselves. In verse 9, that 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 9. He said, but we had the sentence of death in ourselves. That we should not trust in ourselves, but in God, which raised the dead. Who delivered us from so great a death, and who deliver us. In one we trust that he will yet deliver us. They went through a lot of challenges. Listen, my dear, my brothers and my sisters. In the book of James chapter 1, James was written to the 12 tribes which were scattered abroad. They were scattered because of tribulations. They were scattered because of trials and challenges. People were getting persecuted, and people were getting beheaded. And they were running after scattered, trying to find their life. And then James wrote in the book of James chapter 1, in verse 2, he said, brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. He said, count it all joy when you are going through challenges. Count it all joy when you're going through trials. Count it all joy when you're going through crisis. He said, because there is a test of your faith. God want to know whether in your challenges, do you still trust me? Do you still believe that I am able to turn your situation around? Do you still trust me that I died for you, that I will work all things for that together for your good? And God is saying, count it all joy when you fall into various trials and tribulations. He said, because the testing of your faith. Work at patient.
Yes.
That means you have to be patient. He said, the testing of your faith, what?
Work at
patience. Look at that scripture right quick. James chapter 1. Look at that scripture. I want you to see that scripture for yourself so that you can be encouraged. In James chapter 1, starting from verse 1, like I said earlier, that James, speaking to the 12 tribes scattered abroad, in James chapter 1, verse 1, said, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greetings. He said, my brethren, if you are in James chapter 1, say amen.
Amen.
I don't want to go past anybody here. I want you to see the scripture for yourself and let the Holy Spirit download it into your heart. Hallelujah. In James chapter 1, reading from verse 2, James says, my brethren, count it all joy. Did he say count it all sadness? Did he say count it all grief? Then why are we grieving when we're going through challenges? Why are we grieving? Why are we murmuring and complaining and as if we are the only one going through those things? He said, count it all joy. Well, you know, it's not easy to count it all joy. If you are in the flesh, and somebody says, it's okay, you be saying, man, you don't know what I'm going through. As if you are the only one going through that thing. But James said, listen, let me give you the power of the resurrection. Let me give you a revelation. Let me show you how to overcome your situation. Let me show you how to walk in your victory. Let me show you the way out of your situation. The Bible says that the people should carry on what? Joy when they fall into diverse temptation or trials. Look at what it says in verse 3. It said, knowing this, I want you to know this. I want you to know this. Knowing what? What did James want you to know? He said, knowing this, that the trying of your what?
Faith.
The trying of your faith worketh what?
Patience.
That means, brothers and sisters, you need patience. Be And you go to the hospital and they write you a prescription. Won't you be patient? By using the prescription video, everything is getting out of. So God said, be patient. In these days, we like a fast food, a remote things. We want something to clap our hand, the TV go over. We just want something that, you know, we want everything fast. We don't want, we are so much conditioned to that way of life that we don't want to be patient. And when God is working in us, God said, be patient. Because God is saying, there's a test to your faith. What is happening there? Satan is the one that is bringing trial, because the Bible says we cannot be tested. God did not test us with temptation. We are not tested by God through temptation. It is the enemy who came to, the Bible says, comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So he has come to test your faith. Oh, you say you are a Christian. You go to church. Let's see how you're going to react when I do this, when I do that. And then you sure reacting the way he wants you to react. You murmuring, you complaining, you saying you are the only person going through this. So you keep a pity party, and people join with you and pity party with you. And you say, God have left me, and all kind of stuff. And you begin to lose your hope in God. And then the next thing is, I'm not going to that church no more. I've been going there for all this year, and ain't nothing happened. You see, now the problem is no longer you. The problem is either it's God or that church or that pastor. And then you got away from your blessing. That's what Satan wants you to do. That is the thing that he's planning to take you out. Yeah. And you find yourself not going to church no more. You find yourself not going to Bible study no more. You find yourself not doing the things of God no more. Then what next do you do? You go back to your whole friends. All the world, the place where God delivered you from. And then you hang up, we hang around with all those negative people. Then you're making the matter worse. And God and the devil say, I got him now. So, God saying, in the midst of your trials, be patient. Because if you trust me that I am your father, I don't know. If you truly believe God is your father, I don't care what you are going through. God will work it out. He's a God of mercy. We just read it. He's a God of mercy who came to comfort us. He will comfort you in your situation. He will tell you that, hey, have you read the book of Job? Do you know what Job went through? He went through so much that when everything got lost and he got sick, his wife said, just curse this God that you serve and die. Curse God. He said, you are talking like a foolish woman. He said, I came into this world naked. I'm going back naked. He said, God give it and God take it away. He said, you're talking foolish as a foolish woman. Listen. The Father of mercy, whom you serve, is able to establish you, is able to supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. God of mercy is able to establish you. That is why he's saying that, count it all joy. Don't be sad. Don't throw away in the towel. Don't lose hope when challenges and crises come against you. He said, keep on praising him. Keep on worshiping him. You are, why are you worshiping him when you are going through crisis? Why are you keeping filling your heart with joy when you are going through crisis? Because you trust. You trust that this is just a moment, because weeping may endure for a night. Joy is coming in the morning. Hallelujah. Jesus used an example of a woman in travail. Jesus uses that word of a woman in travail. That when a woman is carried and is in the hospital about to give birth, when he's going through sorrow, he's going through pain. But the day that woman released that baby out of that womb, the Bible says the joy comes into the world. That no matter what, the pain might be lingering, you might be going through that crisis, but the weeping just is going to endure for a night, because your joy is coming in the morning. Because you put your trust in God. Amen? Amen. Your trust is in God. Yes. So it's a kind of joy when you fall into various trials and temptation. Because knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience and involves 4 says, but let patience have its perfect work. Let patience have its perfect work. He said, without you wanting anything. That means, during the time that you are trusting God, I'm not talking about passive patience. I'm not talking about waiting in suffering. Waiting while you are suffering. I'm just looking and say, okay, I will just endure. I will take it. No, I'm talking about praising and worship and action. Thanking God that people look at you. They say, man, she don't have no problem or what? Yeah, you got a problem. But you refuse to let your problem overshadow you. You refuse to let your problem to have victory over you. Because all they see is joy. You are having joy because you know that there is a little moment of time. I'm in my patient time and I trust my God and I know God is going to work it out for me. Are you with me? He said that patient has a perfect work. Jesus in the book of John, in the book of John chapter 16, if you look there with me, in that book of John chapter 16, Jesus had just been talking about his departure. John chapter 16. Hallelujah. In John chapter 16, Jesus had just been talking about his departure. He's talking about himself leaving the disciples that he's about to be glorified and go to his Father in heaven. And the Bible says that the disciples were sorrowful. They were so sorrowful because Jesus just said, I'm about to leave you guys. But in the previous chapter, he already told them that, hey, I will not leave you comfortless. Even though I'm going into heaven to go and prepare a place for you. That I'm going to come back to come and pick you up and take you to where I am. And he's saying that, I will not leave you comfortless because I will send you a comforter who is going to reveal all my teaching to you. And then as they were sorrowful about the departure of Jesus Christ, about his announcement that he's going to be put to death, buried, and he will be raised up from death and be glorified by the Father. And while Jesus was saying this word, the Bible says in the book of John 16, let us look from verse 32. 32 says, behold, the hour cometh yet, is now come, that ye shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I'm not alone. Because the Father is with me. But all those things that Jesus has encouraged the people, in verse 33, Jesus now is finalizing his message here. He said, these things I have spoken to you. These things I have spoken to you. That in me, you might what? Have peace. Is that not what he said?
Yes.
That in me ye might have peace. He said, in this world ye shall what? Have tribulation. That in this world you're going to have crisis. In this world you're going to have some challenges, obstacles coming your way to slow you down, to hinder you from fulfilling your destiny. But here Jesus is saying, I'm saying all this unto you that in me may have speed. Because in this world you are going to face all these challenges and tribulation.
Yeah.
But look at what Jesus said at the last phrase. He said, but be of what? Good cheer.
Yeah.
Is that not, does that not mean to rejoice? He said, be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. You are the victory. You are more than a conqueror through me. I will cause you to triumph because I have the victory and I've given you the power, the ability to face all your obstacles and to win in life. But what is the conclusion of this message? The conclusion of this message is patient. 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 Stop thinking that God is nowhere for you. Stop thinking that God is not there for you. Stop thinking that God has forsaken you or is no more in your life. God will not leave any one of his children. We have read the story of the prodigal son. No matter what the prodigal son did, he came back home and God received him back as his beloved. But patience is a powerful word. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse 35, the Bible says, cast not your confidence, which are a great recompense of reward. Talk to Hebrews 35. Hebrews chapter 10. The book of Hebrews chapter 10. I want to feed your spirit with the word of God. Look at Hebrews chapter 10. 35 and 36. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35 says what? If you are there, say amen.
Amen.
Can I hear amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. In Hebrews 35, and in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35 says, cast not away your what? Your confidence, which have what? A great recompense of reward. Verse 36 says, because you are in need of what? Is that what it says? Is everybody in the Bible with me?
Yes.
In verse 35, it says, cast not away therefore your confidence, which are great recompense of reward. There's a reward for your confidence in God. And then verse 36 says, for ye have need of what? God is talking to you here. He said, you have need of patience. Now, what did he say? What was the next phrase? That after you have done what? After you have done the will of God, you may what? Receive the promise. You want to receive the promise of God. You want to receive the blessing of God, but you have no patience. Many times we abort our dreams. Many times we abort our vision, the purpose of God in our life, because of lack of patience. We got to be patient. We got to allow God to work out our situation. We got to trust God that He is able, we are in a good hand. Satan don't like that. That is why it's messing with you. It's messing with you so that you can throw in the towel. It's messing with you so that you can say, I don't think this Christian thing worked for me. And then that's what he wants you to do, to quit. No, trust in the living God. Amen?
Amen.
The Bible says in the book of Hebrews, chapter 6, verse 13, the Bible says, when God made a promise to Abraham, saying, in blessing I will bless you, and in multiplying I will multiply you. The Bible says, after Abraham had what? Patiently endured, he received the promise. Abraham had patiently endured. This is God's promise to Abraham, that I'm going to bless you. He said, in blessing, I will bless you. In Hebrews chapter 6, verse 10. He said, in blessing, I will bless you. And in multiplying, I will multiply you. And the Bible says, after Abraham had patiently endured, he received the promise. Do you know how old Abraham was before he got the child? Do you know how many years Abraham waited before he had a child? That revelation from God, and he heard the voice of God, for God visited him. He visited him and said, I'm going to give you a child, and you're going to be a blessing to all nations. I can see Abraham say, okay, praise the Lord, tomorrow I'm going to have a baby. Next month, 1 year, 2 years, 5 years. I don't think this, I think why you just come to lie to me? And you say, I'm going to have a child. 10 years. Abraham could have said, man, this is, I can see Abraham even at 80 years, he was still saying, because the Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 4, that Abraham without hope believed in hope. That means in the natural, it was impossible for a 80, 90-year-old to have a baby. But Abraham do not look at his body. The Bible says Abraham looked up on God. He put his trust in God. God said it, he would do it. So instead of Abraham aborting that dream and that vision and the voice of God, Abraham was patiently enough. He was patient enough, and the Bible says that after 25 years that God has promised Abraham a child, he received that promise. How many of us, after 1 month or five days, you say, hey, I don't think God will give me that job. I don't think, 5 days. And here comes a man that spent 25 years. Look at what the Bible says about him in Romans chapter 4. Look at Romans chapter 4, quick. I will close with this. Romans chapter 4, let me close with this. Romans chapter 4. Are you with me? If you are there, say amen.
Amen.
Romans chapter 4. The Bible says in verse 17, as it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God who quickened the dead and called those things which be not as though they were. Now verse 18 says, Abraham who against all believed in hope. That means in the natural there was no hope, but his hope is in God. God said it. I'm not going to quit. One day that baby going to come. I don't care if I'm 25,000 years old. That baby is going to come. I'm not going to die until that manifestation of my blessing. Amen?
Amen.
So he's saying here, he says in verse 18, who against hope, believing hope, that he might become the father of many nations, according to what? To that which was spoken. Abraham only faith, his only faith is according to what God has spoken. God said it, and God will do it. I don't care what is going on in the natural. I don't care what is going on around me. God said it, he will do it. So the Bible says in verse 19, he was not weak. He said, be not weak in faith. He considered not his own body. Abraham did not look at 90-year-old body. He looked at himself and said, I'm still young. And he said, my wife is still young to have a baby. So the Bible says, and being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body now dead, when he was about 100-year-old. Neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. Look at verse 20. The Bible says, he staggered not at the promise of God. He did not waver. He did not have no doubt at the promise that God promised him. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving glory to God. He was so strong. Every day he would just say, Father, I thank you for the promise that you promised me of a child. I know it has not yet, my season has not yet come. But I patiently wait for you. I know you are not a man that you should lie, nor the son of man that you should repent. You have said it, you will do it. you have spoken it. You will make it good. I am going to wait for you. I am going to wait for your promise because I do believe that you are able to supply all my needs according to your riches. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Is God is able? Do you believe God is able?
Yes.
To make a way for you?
Yes.
Where there seems to be no way.
Yes.
Do you believe God is able?
Yes.
To uphold you and to strengthen
yes.
you? Lord,
yes.
God is able.
Yes.
No matter what you are going through, trust in Him. Stand in His word.
Yes.
Believe Him. Do not waver. He's going to bring it to pass.
Yes.
You just keep on doing the right thing. You just keep on coming to church.
Yes.
You just keep on reading your Bible. You just keep on praising and worshiping Him. You just keep on praying to Him. You just keep on giving Him all the glory. You can just keep on walking with Him.
Amen.
He will never fail you. He will never fail you.
Yes.
You are here this morning. And you want God to transform your life. You are going through challenges. You are going through crises. And you want God to do great things for you. By the power of the Holy Spirit and the presence of the Holy Spirit that is in this place, I want to pray with you and for you.